And the mission of New England Wildflower Society is to conserve and promote the region's native plants to ensure healthy, biologically diverse landscapes. Biological diversity is something that, like I said, we live and breathe every single day. It's very important to us that people are acknowledging that landscapes are part of a much larger ecosystem. And that biological diversity in the landscape is something that helps to support the local ecosystems that are important for our health and well-being, and for the environment as a whole. So we do this in a number of different ways. One of the ways that I think is most exciting is just in valuing the unique character of individual plants. Anyone identify this species? It's all cornflower, right? Yeah, this is T. rella cornifolia. I took all these shots with my phone in about 2.5 minutes time. This spring, out in the Curtis Woodland Garden, which is a new garden that we're, not a new garden, but a garden we're in the process of restoring here at Garden in the Woods. And what do you notice about the leaf shape and the texture and the form of all these?
Varied, right?
They're very varied. Every single one of these plants was grown from a single seed. And this is a wild ecotype, T. rella cordifolia, that our nursery manager, Kate McDonough, collected. This is a prime example of what genetic diversity looks like on the landscape. It really doesn't do a whole lot to interpret why it's important, but it at least sends the message home to the average homeowner or the average home gardener that plants are unique. Each individual plant grown from a seed has a unique genetic makeup. Is important for building a healthy ecosystem. So when you combine T. rella cordifolia, grown from wild collected seed, with phlox stolonifera, a cultivar called, this is all phlox avaricata, a cultivar called Blue Moon, that's all very consistent because it was all grown from the same exact genetic stock. It's a great opportunity to actually interpret the differences and similarities between and among species, and to showcase and highlight for people how plants are grown differently. And the fact that we grew all of this foam flower from seed and all the phlox was grown from cuttings is a really good example on the landscape of how people can start to see the differences and similarities between plants that were grown either from cuttings and all exactly genetically identical, or from seed, like the foam flower was grown here. What we discovered through the master planning process was that sourcing of local ecotype material that's been grown from seed that was wild collected is incredibly difficult in a large scale, on a large scale. And as we look to build out large sections of Garden in the Woods through this master planning process, sourcing that material is going to be increasingly difficult. If we need 30,000 or 40,000 or 50,000 plugs, growing those ourselves is somewhat challenging. Finding them in local nurseries is very challenging because people just aren't really growing this material on a large scale. And so today's topic is really about, this very subject, really about understanding why this subject is important, the challenges of trying to grow local ecotype material, the challenges of trying to source local ecotype material for small scale and large scale projects, just a really good introduction into our commitment to growing plants that are genetically diverse, our commitment to genetically diverse landscapes, our very challenging commitment to even growing spore, or growing ferns from spore. As you can see in this image, it requires quite a bit of infrastructure. With that, I'd like to introduce Michael Piantadosi and ask him to come up and give us a little bit of insight into the work that he's doing with the Seeds of Success program and collecting seed on a very large scale.
So I introduce myself. I have a degree in plant biology from the University of New Hampshire. I've done a variety of work, different jobs in horticulture and agriculture and botany for the past decade, and somehow wound up here doing this work and wearing a wide variety of hats. as anyone who's ever worked in a nonprofit knows, you tend to do everything and a little bit of everything all the time. That's definitely true of our conservation department. My title is NEPCOP/Seed Bank Coordinator. I'm also the coordinator of the Seeds of Success program, which I'll talk a bit about a little later. NEPCOP stands for the New England Plant Conservation Program, and is a six-state consortium of academic institutions, botanical organizations, conservation organizations, and botanists doing surveys and seed collections of rare native species and seed collections that eventually are accessioned into our seed bank. And without those volunteers, we really couldn't do the work we've done now for the past 25 years. Anyway, the topic I would like to talk about a bit today is ex situ conservation and how we apply a seed bank, also how we go about using wild collected seed for restoration projects throughout New England. So this is just an introductory photo of National Park Service, Boston Harbor Islands, a property we're working at currently with Seeds of Success to restore some of their habitat, and then a brief photo of our seed bank in the drying room. I start most of my talks off with this slide. It's a quote I think is sort of inspiring, and so maybe you'll take something from it. Plants are vital to the future of humanity and all living things, and seeds are the genesis of it all. It makes me feel really important. So thank you for this information. Anyway, a bit about seed banking. Habitat or in-situ conservation versus captive or ex-situ conservation, both work in tandem to preserve all species throughout New England. You need botanical institutions as much as you need wild habitat in order to use the seed bank. It's kind of useless to have thousands and thousands of bits of germplasm when you can never apply it to the natural world, and vice versa, to not have that insurance policy of having seeds and genetic diversity banked for long-term conservation. We typically use our seed bank for restoration, augmentation, and reintroduction occasionally of a lot of native flora in New England. And when it comes to protection of species, in-situ conservation doesn't really help with succession. And in New England, you typically have every habitat going to forest. You have shrub growth, and then you have the trees that grow in. So most of the herbaceous layer would be wiped out, especially with suppression of wildfires and differences in climate change and all of that. Anyway, there's some of that too. The difference between seed bank, of course, is that you're shielded from pests and weather events and shifts in climate, as well as artificial selection and genetic drift and other things that affect wild populations. Many more individuals can be stored. Seeds are relatively small. It's a pretty good bargain to operate a seed bank, and ours has worked out quite well. Genetic diversity of the species is preserved, and large numbers of plants can be grown from seed. I'm going to kind of touch on two different aspects of what we do with seed collection, one being endangered species and one being common native plants, and how those differ, both in their collection and the procedure to do that, as well as how they're applied from a seed bank. So our seed bank of endangered species has roughly 980 accessions, so individual collections. This is dating back to 1989, this is the earliest collection, at the beginning of the New England Plant Conservation Program, which is much smaller than it is now, covering 185 different taxa and over 440 occurrences. An occurrence you can think of just as a given taxa in a given place. So you may have one species in New Hampshire on the coastline and another in central Maine on the coast. That's an occurrence. There also have been about 10 collections from this year, from 2016, and but just under 120 from last year that have yet to be tested and actually accessioned in the bank. So that number will rise quite soon. Seed banks in general. You may be familiar with the seed bank in Svalbard built into permafrost for global food security and typically focused on agricultural crops. That's nothing like our seed bank. It's basically a freezer. It's not quite that advanced. But please donate. The Millennium Seed Bank does focus on wild crops and agricultural crops, and we tend to go back and forth with Pew on a lot of our protocols and how we operate the bank. We are also a founding member of the CPC, the Center for Plant Conservation, and we just had a meeting for the CPC here in May of this year. We We are one of the founding members of 1985, 39 institutions, actually probably a few more now. But their national collections have about 788 species from all over the country. It's another bank that is critically important to protecting the entire continental U.S. For our continental U.S. And you see us up there in pink, us in the Arnold Arboretum, representing a lot of things. We typically use a set of more basic than you might expect matrices for seed collection. A lot of it is based on what priorities we have, basically what have we not yet collected of endangered species or threatened species, what has now become endangered or been taken off the conservation list, or what seeds we have to look at based on their recalcitrant or unorthodox behavior. Oftentimes you're hit with what's called recalcitrant seed. That's typically a seed, a germplasm that is filled mostly of lipids or fats, and therefore can't be dried down and stored long term. Think of the entire genus Quercus, all oaks and acorns. You can't store them long term beyond food value. This is also true of things like fern spores. We have a very difficult time with ferns, and we're still doing a lot of research into how we can bank those, because equally, there are many of those that are in danger of critical conservation concern. So we work, as I said, through all six states with many volunteers and give them this kind of priority list. Typically, each season, this is what we share with our volunteers and botanists. Less than 10% of seed from populations with 1 to 5 occurrences, or an S1 rank, throughout the states. So that means there's only less than 5 populations still extant in the wild. Is our first focus, and we try to get collections of seed from all of them on a shifting basis. Usually 3 to 5 years, we try to return to a site. Collecting every year in succession can actually damage the population significantly. So we don't do that. It doesn't really make much sense to build a seed bank when you're wiping out the net of the current population. Also, of the S2 populations, we try to focus on genetic diversity. So we go to the outliers of those populations. Regardless of size of the population, we focus more on spatial differences. So, a population of a given taxa by the coast and one in the mountain, floodplain. And for the next couple of years, sorry, this year and some of last year, we're trying to focus on spatial distribution and GIS analysis. This means basically mapping out collections we do have in our seed bank, where they come from, and what regions and what locations we have yet to collect seed from. Again, this is all with the idea of getting as much diversity as possible. The hope being that if you have seed collected of a given species from a variety of populations in a state, you can then expect that you've covered most of the alleles and genetic variants within that population, and makes for much more successful reintroduction if necessary. This is not much of a slide. You can go to sleep for 30 seconds. Basically, I'm talking about how a seed ripens and what it looks like when it's ripe. This is what we give a lot of our volunteers. But it is true that timing is most important to seed collection. You have to be there at exactly the right time, which makes large-scale collection very difficult, and then when you talk about endangered species, which has 2 populations left in the middle of the White Mountain National Forest, it also makes it difficult. You have a clock ticking. Also, getting those seeds and then getting them into a drying bin or a drying room is next important. If you don't do that, you really have continued metabolism going in the seed, and the seed just begins to die as soon as it's made. Ripening is actually usually considered slow death is what it is. So drying slows that metabolism significantly, or freezing continues to slow it to a point where basically a static living condition. Color is something that I would not even read that. That's almost there's so much variability in that one sentence, I don't even agree with that. Typically we collect seed from when things are in natural dispersal, so when pods are opening or when seeds are falling out of a capsule. That's the time when you're pretty sure it's ripe. Or when berries are red, or berries look like they're good for eating. Think of how it would normally get to where it's going. Mostly animals, or wind, or these things. Rule yourself out for a minute, and you'll know when natural dispersal is happening. There's an example of natural dispersal. That seed's ready to fall off. That's Carex crinita. And it's swollen, and the seeds are just ripe. There's natural dispersal. That's a squiggly spot. That's obviously open, ready to go into the air. And there's a reason I didn't say color is any kind of indication. That's archaea. That's a white fruit, which, you know, is exactly what that quote says is not true. So that's ripe also. Anyway, again, 10% of the seed from individuals. We collect less than 10% of the seed from individual plants and 10% from the entire population of the endangered species that we work with. Now, that is actually half the amount recommended by Q and through former research to be yet more conservative in our collections. Really, we want a representation of germplasm more than we do a bulk collection for a restoration project. Our endangered species seed collection, our seed bank, is typically focused on relatively small amounts of seed that we'll use in the absolute necessity that a population is going to blink out. Whereas our SOS seed of success collections are very different. So I want to highlight that 10% rule. We also collect on maternal lines. So we collect one individual packet for each fruiting stem. Now what this does is account for hybridization among populations where you may have mixing between one flower and the next. You know, viola is a good example. Its violets tend to hybridize like crazy. So this is a way of kind of correcting for that. And getting enough diversity to get up to about 50 plants, individual fruit, typically gives you the diversity of that population pretty well. It's very well represented. And then they won't send them to me, and I put them in the bank. And what the bank looks like. So this is at least the drying room out in Asami in Wayland, Massachusetts. And you can kind of see the schematic of there's a processing room for seed cleaning that I don't do any of it, typically the staff in Asami do. I do a lot of it here, actually just in the building next door throughout the winter. So if any of you are around with free time, my cookies are pretty good. It's as much of a treat as I'll give you, otherwise there's no laughing and no fun involved. It's very serious work. But yeah, it is honestly, each collection that we get of endangered species we work with very personally. We count each individual seed, we look at each one to see that it looks good, it hasn't been damaged by herbivory or by mold. Then it's accessioned to the seed bank. So ideally, our collections are representative of a genetic population, significant diversity, and they're all just beautiful, perfect, happy seeds. That's very accurate. Anyway, there's also the cold room and the drying room, which a lot of our seed collections are at, and these are some images of that. That's the door opening, that nest block. This is inside the room, what it looks like. It's kind of a behind the scenes. And then typically, seed collections, after being dried down for 4 or 5 months, are then foil packed and heat sealed and then put into the seed bank, which is a freezer at negative 20 degrees Celsius. So that's what it looks like. Not that exciting. Anyway, this is the exciting part. So this is how we use a lot of those seeds that are in the bank. Astragalus rubensii, variety Jessippii, Jessup's milkfetch. This is a small pea that grows in 3 locations on the planet. All of them are on the Connecticut River between Vermont and New Hampshire. It grows in a very specific habitat, which is to say, really difficult to traverse rock ledges. As you can see it all here, the purple flower along those ledges. Myself and our director, Bill Grumbach, go up to this site usually 2 or 3 times a year to both monitor the plants that we put in and then augment the population. And it's been over 5 years of doing that. I've been part of the past 2. But as of now, the data is showing that our augmentation has improved the soil seed bank that exists at this site, and therefore we can basically pull back and stop having plants there. Again, in conservation, I mean, the mentality is typically that you don't want to have as much manipulation as possible. You'd rather not be gardening. You'd rather let things do what they do. So only be there as long as you're absolutely necessary. And these populations are doing significantly better than they were a decade ago, and much better than 5 years ago. So we will obviously keep monitoring this, but we're in really good shape. And it's worked because of the seed bank. Had we not had that seed bank of this exact site, of those seeds, it wouldn't have worked quite as well. There are the seeds as they're growing in seedlings. They're very small. And there's the rank and distribution. You can actually ignore the green spotted mane. That's another variety. That's a long story. Anyway, other things we're doing. So Sebaceous stolaris, the annual rose gentian. This is one that I'm actually analyzing the effects of desiccation and drying on seeds before they're put into the seed bank for long-term storage. So as I said, drying is typically the most critical, one of the most critical aspects of banking seed for long-term. And in this case, it actually kills the seed. So now we've got to find another way around to plant and remediate these populations without drying down the seed, which means selling it fresh, or it means growing it out perpetually. We don't get enough. Anyway, this year has been a lot of experimenting, working with the Connecticut Department of Energy and Environmental Protection with protecting this endangered species. Mimulus elatus, this is one I'll go into a little more detail with. Also kind of along the Connecticut River floodplain, tends to focus on riverine habitat in western Massachusetts, where we're working with it. We also do what are called remediation projects. So the State Natural Heritage Bureau will contact us and say that so-and-so construction company wants to put new wellheads in. So they have to reroute a section of the river. So you go out and tell us what species occur there. So we go out and we happen to find endangered species. Now when that happens, Massachusetts is the only state in the entire country that the Endangered Species Act actually has teeth in law. With an endangered species, it's a 3-to-1 augmentation. So you have to take 3 times the amount that is occurring and will be moved or destroyed and replant it or financially make up for it. In this case, we're able to go to the site that was about to be plowed over, collect seed from it, and then find adequate locations along the Mill River to plant it in adjacent rivers and tributaries. The seed is incredibly tiny. If you've ever seen any of the mimulus, their seeds are on the same scale of orchid seeds. They're like dust, which explains my scattered method of planting it. We grew these plants out. I grew them in the greenhouse just over there. From collections we made in 2014, grew them into plugs, and then we got in our kayaks and went out looking for mudflats. Not the most exciting thing to look for. Anyway, we did find a lot of these south-facing mudflats. It's a very specific habitat for this one species. And you had issues like this. So that's me looking at a long day of work. Basically, it's very difficult to kayak or canoe with, you know, canoes full of flats of plugs when you have miles and miles of downed trees. There's a reason no one's ever been on the Mill River. That's the reason. So anyway, we also moved the plants that were going to be destroyed and tried to find locations for them. Got them down there and planted them. In fact, this one is very close to Nasami. It's right on the bend by the nursery. It's the biggest of all. Shifting gears a little bit. So that was all endangered species, plants that are threatened, and what we do and how we can use seed bank to augment populations, to restore them, and to remediate critical conservation status points. This, the Seeds of Success project, especially in the East, is kind of our focus for 2015 and 2016, and it's built to provide a niche that really doesn't exist, and that is locally adapted genotypes to large-scale restoration projects of wild collected seed. Now, the way this differs right off the bat is typically a restoration project wants compositional species. It wants everything that is native that occurs at a given habitat. So if you have a salt marsh, you want all the salt marsh grasses. If you have a river floodplain, you want everything that represents a river floodplain. It also needs thousands and thousands more seeds than a seed bank does. So these are bulk collections, typically 3 to 15 pounds each collection. Seeds of Success itself is kind of more of a Western thing. BLM initiated this, I think, 2 decades ago. And it focuses on rangeland and pasture land, typically, also where BLM has to own properties. Implementing it on the East Coast came about as a result of Hurricane Sandy and the damages that caused, and trying to rebuild with FEMA money and network money some of those habitats that were damaged. So we represent the entire New England region. There's also another botanical organization, the Mid-Atlantic Regional Seed Bank, with the Parks Department of New York, working for the Mid-Coast. They have, I think, New York to Maryland, and then south down to Virginia and North Carolina is the North Carolina Botanical Garden. They do the seed collections there. So between the three organizations, we focus on the entire Atlantic coastline and providing seeds to restoration projects up and down. Now, it's kind of unique because as you see this map showing some of the properties owned by BLM, That's where we are, and there are none of them. Actually, BLM owns less than 4% of the land in the East. So a lot of our work is in getting permission to actually go just collect seeds. You can't just walk into someone's backyard and pick up a bunch of, sweet peas. You have to ask. So that's a lot of like work. Whereas BLM and all the Western SOS projects can just kind of go up to BLM properties and get work. It was funded by NFWF, the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, and the Department of the Interior for us to do this work for 2 years. And the difficulty we're facing now is what happens after this year? Where does this go? And with climate change and with the shifts in environment, the sea level rise, with all these various issues, this seems more critical now than ever. Unfortunately, a lot of funding doesn't tend to come as a preventative measure. It tends to come afterwards to fix the problems that you could. Anyway, we focus these collections much the same way as with our endangered species. They are focused on a given project, as where the green star is up there, and then working immediately outside of that location to find conservation parcels or large populations of representative species to collect. So there's a variety of moving parts. And I apologize if I'm spitting on all these variables, but there's so many different things to think about with each collection. It gets kind of complicated. But this is the basic idea, is we go as close as possible to that restoration location, and we find everything that represents that habitat that's going to happen. So in this case, the dam removal. So what you want to focus on is a riverine floodplain, somewhere that when they take that dam out, all of this habitat is going to be soaked, and there's going to be silt and clay distribution and soil that's going to rise. So what's going to happen to this population? So we have to figure out how to deal with that. So there's a lot of thinking ahead. The other difficulty is, in a lot of the populations, a lot of the sites that restoration work is happening, you have many, many non-native and invasive species that have taken over. So we have to look back in time to think what represents this type of habitat in southeastern Massachusetts or in northwestern Maine, and how do you approach that? Shifting gears a little bit to why we do it that way. So this, you may all have seen, this is Clausen, Keck, and Heisey. This is an old paper that talks about variance among a given species and among subspecies dependent on environmental conditions. This is just a general graph showing you, basically, plants that were native to this location didn't do well in a different location of the same species. It's as simple as that. It goes on though, and in dark gray in this left-hand side, you can see where those plants were native to, and when they planted out across a given range. So you can think about it going across the row, you're looking at phenotypic difference in a given site, so how a plant adapts at different locations. So in this case, it's elevation. So you see the plants planted at 100 feet, 4,000 feet, 10,000, and how they tend to do. This is typically how you wind up with subspecies. So more often than not, in a long-term situation, you have so much genetic plasticity or phenotypic plasticity that the genetic makeup of something is shifting. So over time, it just splits completely. One good example of this is among the seaside goldenrod, Solidago sempervirens, which has two subspecies in New England. They tend to grow in very different environments. There's one that grows in a sand dune, and there's one that grows directly in a salt marsh with other salt marsh grasses. Very different habitats. And need very different phenotypic differences to survive. That happens over a very short time period. Sometimes we forget that it's happening and just make bulk collections. So again, we're on this personal level with these seed collections where we'd like to provide the exact correct species at the time. Here's another example of the same researchers focusing on Achillea. And this is just above altitude, but it's a really simple little graph that just shows you that plants grown at a low altitude and planted at a high altitude tend not to do so well, and vice versa. It's as simple as looking at things like this. But this is true of all other dynamic aspects of an ecosystem, not just altitude and elevation. Back to some of our projects we're working on currently. We have 14 different restoration projects throughout New England that we're working with to provide them plant materials. The only thing we don't do is propagate. We assist them in giving them guidance as to who can propagate this bulk amount of native seed of this weird carex or this weird sedge or something, which is really difficult and a really specialized field. So it's, that's kind of the limiting factor at this point in this project. We do collect the seed, we clone the seed at NRCS facility in New Jersey, sent back to us and then sent to the project. And I should say a small portion of each one of these bulk collections is also sent out to Pullman, Washington, to a USDA facility where it's kept for long-term conservation storage. What they're doing out there is growing out these plants and collecting seed from them, building up the stock that they have of, you know, let's say a little blue stem from Essex County. They're focused on making these seeds available for long-term restoration. So it's not just going to be available for these next 2 years, but hopefully into the future and could be funded even further. One of our projects in Pittsfield is a dam removal, greenway implementation. It's a terribly devastated habitat, but one where I'm thinking often about what would occur in this habitat, because everything there is from Japan or from Eurasia. Some of the places we do collect and some of the nice sites. So this is an area in Rhode Island where we're collecting Spartina alternate flora. Commonly, salt marsh burgrass is commonly grown in salt marsh restoration because it is what is holding together our salt marshes. Without this plant, you don't have salt marsh habitat. It goes away. The root system keeps it intact. Dune habitat. This is at Parker River National Wildlife Refuge in Newbury, Massachusetts. Amophila brevoligulata, the seagrass, we call it, hold together the sand dunes. Without that, you don't have that habitat. Often we forget that when we're talking about habitat, we're typically talking about geology and the flora and the plant life. And that's mostly what's making up a habitat. So you need these components to remain steady. A wooded habitat, we do seed collection from, it means a kind of diversity in our collection and a break from the coastline. And that's up in Greenfield, New Hampshire. Also with the Boston Harbor Islands, as I showed initially, an interesting project because you're working with a series of islands in this chain in the Boston Harbor, where the question comes up as, do you move seeds from Great Island to Thompson Island? Is that appropriate? Well, it depends on how the dispersal method is. If a bird is going to fly from one island to the next, it seems totally reasonable to use that population over there. If it's wind dispersed, maybe not. Maybe the winds just don't blow in that direction, typically. Anyway, lots of questions. This is the seaside goldenrod growing right on a sand dune, on top of it, as I mentioned. I just wanted to show you some pretty photos. Some of our seed collections and what they start to look like. This is just from this year. We've made about 10 collections this year. We're kind of waiting for everything to really seed out and then start working. We have four interns that we work with to do this work, myself and them. I've been in the field most of the past month doing this. These are a few different juncus and carex, so different gram noise. And what happens to those seeds before they're sent to cleaning is we dry them out right next door in a way that makes it look like, you know, casserole from hell or something. But that's the next step. And you can see, this is actually a small image of how much goes through this one step and how large these seed collections are. Of these, you know, fuzzy little seed collections, those are a scirpus, a bulrush. So you'll probably have, you know, 500 million seeds in there. I mean, a lot of these are very, very tiny. Anyway. Another restoration project in Rhode Island we're working on, where you can see them putting in coir logs to kind of stop the erosion that's happening at the salt marsh, to give us a bit of time to actually grow up plugs of the salt marsh plants and plant them in there. And I believe, yeah, and some kind of good news. So last year we did a lot of these collections. We made 254 collections in 4 months, totaling something like 80 million seeds, covering 89 different species. One of them is the Spartina alternate flora, the salt marsh foregrass, which they are replanting in some of these heavily eroded areas. This is the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in Rhode Island, and what they're doing is they've dredged a lot of that sediment and sand and soil material and placed it on parts of the salt marsh that have been eroding. After they do that and have that soil type there, they're able to plant the plugs of those locally adapted seeds at that site. And net them off so the crows don't pluck them up. But slowly, you'll see that grass moves vegetatively, it fills in, and that habitat comes back. you're looking at acres and acres that can be restored just by being able to go collect wild seed. It's a really simple method. It just kind of needs some basic funding and protocols. We're working on that. This is the first step. And sometimes we give directly back to the I think that's all I've got to talk about today. Thank you.
Please help me welcome Peter Rainbow. So, to introduce myself and our nursery, we're a nursery in New Hampshire. We grow 800 or 900 varieties, and we grow about 700,000 finished plants a year. And we ship them into the four northern New England states, and sometimes into Connecticut and New York and Rhode Island. So, we're growers, but we're also marketers. We have to sell things that sell and grow things that sell. So it's been really interesting hearing this conservation angle that Mark and Michael have been presenting, because that doesn't sell plants necessarily. So personally, I've been in the business for 30 years, and the reason I still love this business is because I absolutely love plants, and I live for plants, and I go walking all the time, and if I don't come home with some leaves with llamas in my back pocket, trying to eat out, my family thinks something's wrong, seriously. And when I go on vacation, I plant it because they're cool things to see, and I get the books and I study beforehand. So I love the plants, so this is what I like to talk about, is what I like to do. And working with NUSE, with what we call it, is that whatever you guys call yourself? New England Wildflower Society, has been phenomenal, because we're getting all kinds of stuff that they're propagating, and then we get to grow them, and we get to see the plants grow things that aren't necessarily in the market yet. So our journey into wildflowers is having always been a wildflower enthusiast and being a nurseryman. About over 20 years ago, we said, well, I want to grow in wildflowers too. And this wasn't really a thing at the time. But we thought of wildflowers, and I thought of bloodroot, I thought of trilliums, I thought of hepaticas, I thought of erythroniums. They're really beautiful, they're spring ephemerals. What a mistake that was. Because these, they're not on the market for about 16 reasons. The first reason is they're really, really hard to grow. They take a long, long time. They flower for about 2 days, and then not only they go out of flower, then about 3 days later they go dormant. So you have this little window of time. So if you haven't killed them beforehand, if you don't sell them those 2 days, you waste some throw away a ton of plants. And it was a good lesson, because not only did they not work for us, the market for them was very teeny. This is a teeny market. These specially native ephemerals. And then we were growing trillium grandiflorum, and it was one of the plants we were having success with for a while. And 1 year, I mean, so you collect the seed, and then you sow it out, or you put it in the freezer for stratification. And then the next year, if you're lucky, it germinates. If not, you wait another year, so you're 2 or 3 years. And then you put it in a seed tray for a year, and then a year later, you prick it off and you put it in a liner tray. And then you try and bulk it out in the liner tray, because you don't want to take up too much room in the nursery. And finally, it gets full, and then you put it in another pot, like a 3.5-inch pot, and you let it bulk out. And that's been 3 or 4 years. So this 1 year, man, we nailed it. We like had 500 of these things, and they're beautiful. You see the three little trillium leaves, and then the little trillium flowers. And I brought them to the first garden center, because I was really proud of them. And they looked and said, oh, they're cute. What does that mean? It means, they're dainty. They were little. But to me, I've been waiting for 4 years, and here I have some flowering trillions. I couldn't sell them still. I was going to have to wait another year. So we bagged that project. It's not worth it. So as you can guess, I'm not doing slides, because when I started this talk, it just didn't seem like a slide sort of talk. I probably could have as I went along, but you're going to have to wait. We're winging it here. So that's my trillium story, and that's when we started trying to redefine
what we wanted to do, and we were getting more and more into native plants. So then we had to define native plants as something that was tough, something that was going to solve a landscape problem, not something that was going to just be good for an enthusiast. So we grow more tough plants, native stuff that do well in landscape. That's one of the criteria, do well someplace. Okay. So I was asked to talk about two questions. So the first one is, in addition to offering native plants, should nurseries also offer cultivars of native plants in their inventory? And it's been interesting, because I think Mark asked me that 2 months ago, and I spent a lot of time thinking about that. And at first, I was going, yeah, because, you know, we have to survive, we have to sell things. And, you know, you hear in politics now about the 99% and the 1%. You guys are the 1%, okay? You're not the 99%. I think that 99% of the people who buy plants in a garden center don't know whether it's native or not. I really think that. And we sell a lot of plants to a lot of garden centers. We sell half our plants to garden centers and half our plants to landscapers, so I get to see both sides of this. So, I think species plants are a niche market, and everybody needs to know that, but I think that's changing, and I think it's changing because the 1% is speaking out. We've heard this in politics, and it works, okay? So I think this is really a good place, but I don't think anyone who's going into marketing, unless they can develop this niche, they're going to be successful. That's what the garden and the woods has done. We grow all these funky species plants for the garden and woods only, because they're the people that can sell them. But anyhow, this is part of my thought process that I've been going through as I thought about this talk. So here's the crux. Are New England gardeners willing to forgo bright colors, shorter plants, longer bloom time, bigger flowers, milder resistance for a species plant? Each year I tend to get involved with one meadow project, and it's been a lot of fun. So, and that's for the last 6 or 7 years. And most of the people installing the meadow project are from ELI, from this organization, so they understand the whole shtick. And when I ask them, are we going to talk nativars, or are we doing species? It is, in every case, turned our people want the bright colors. Okay? So, then you have to ask yourself, what are you presenting? Are you making a meadow? Or are you making a meadow garden? And then you have to ask yourself, what is a meadow? What do people see as a meadow? There's a great book out there that I read this winter, and it's called Where the Sky Begins. Anyone read that book? By a guy named John Madison, and he grew up in the Midwest, and he's some kind of ecologist. But he also grew up fishing and hunting and hiking through the prairies. And he wrote this book, and he goes through all this, the flora that we're becoming familiar with, the little blue stem, the big blue stem, and all that stuff. And he's talking about the different sections of the Midwest, and where it grows so wonderfully, and where it doesn't grow so wonderfully, and there's little blue stem meadows, prairies, and there are big blue stem meadows, and there are all these things, and they're different, and they have different ecologies in different places where they grow. And then I was saying to myself as I'm reading this book, we're arrogant enough to think we can produce this in New England where all the conditions he's talking about don't exist. Because when people talk to me about a prairie, they're thinking about that. They're not thinking about the little wetland meadows that you see on the side of streams in New England. In New England, where we have ample rainfall and ample water holding capacity in the soil, we grow trees. Right? So it's a from a horticultural perspective, it's a dilemma. But we grow a lot of those Midwestern plants because A, they do well here, and B, it's what people are expecting of us. So then I got to thinking, when we started this business, before this whole nativar thing came about, there was this saying that we as the Americans, you know, I don't hear this much anymore, you see it a lot. Shipped all the plants over to Europe, and then they gave them an Oxford education and sent them back. So think of phlox paniculatus, and think of monardas, and think of aquilegia. There are all these cultivars, And they went over to the Kew Gardens and all the fancy horticultural gardens, and then they selected them. And they picked nice ones, and they sent them back here, and probably crossed them with some other stuff over there along the way. So I realized when I think about nativars, I'm mostly thinking about that stuff. And then one day, recently, I just sat down with our catalog, and I started thinking, and I realized that's a pretty small selection of what we grow. So besides those, and then you have the new evolution in plants, the cucurbits and the echinaceas, so I don't have to tell anyone what's going on there. Then some people figured out that it might be profitable to breed these things with different colors, and then now there's 18,000 cucurbits and 19,000 echinaceas. They're inbred with every other kind of plant that's closely related to them, and a lot of them don't overwinter it. Okay, so we're sacrificing perennial nature of the plant for these other qualities, and the quality could be a long bloom time. Well, if you get a perennial that has used to a short bloom time, and now you make it bloom for a long time, what's it turning into? It's turning into an annual. It flowers itself to death. It's going to reproduce by seed now, right? So we're doing that. So that's happening with a lot of these plants. So, then I got to looking at our list, and actually, turns out we have like over 50 species that we grow from open pollinated seed, which is kind of cool. So I wrote the list down, I was going to read it to you, but the list got longer and longer and longer. But I'm going to start just because it's kind of fun. Ansonius, Eubrechii and Chardonnay Montana, both great species. Aurelia racemosa, fantastic plant that you can find further west in the state. Arctostaphylus, Aruncus, common garden plant, but it's still grown from seed. Asarum canadensis, still grown from seed. Asclepias tuberosa, there's a couple cultivars. That's going to be the perennial plant of the year next year for the PPA. And it's an open pollinated plant. And the list goes on and on and on and on. Pacrophorius is a great ornamental plant that you don't see used very often, and it's a native. So, and as I look at this list, I can pick out some where there are cultivars that are on the market, but we at least still sell the open pollinated one more. Of all the echinaceas that we grow and that die, Echinacea pallida and Echinacea pensiensis are great. They're tom-tom plants, and they're really cool. They've gone back to the old form, you know, how they used to have reflex petals, and then they brought them up and up and up and up, so it's a normal daisy. Well, they've gone back to reflex petal, which I think is really nice. So, long-lived perennials. Vaccinia, we grow the low bush blueberry. There's all kinds of cultivars, but we sell more of the native one. Veronicastrum virginicum, I know Annie's been working on it. We grow much more of the standard white one than the cultivars. Iris cristata, people are starting to come in with different, this white and that blue, but the native ones sell better. So the other thing you have to notice from this list, and I have a copy of the list if someone wants to see the whole thing afterwards, they're not all native to New England. They're native to the Midwest, which brings up the definition of native, which I think is really interesting. I went to a talk once where they defined native. They said the word native, you should never use the word native without an adjective, without a modifier. Native for what? Right? So he suggested we have three different types. You define a local, a regional, and a national native. Okay, so we've done that. So in our marketing, we have the New England Woodlanders, which is just plants to grow with regionally in New England. And if I can find it either in the New England Wildflowers book or that other one by McGee and somewhere else, if I can find it in there, and it doesn't say that it's escaped from gardens, I included it in the Woodlanders. And then the interesting thing is we have, if you look at the map of New England, there's a ton of great plants that do well in the Appalachians. So, but they do well here, and the theory, and I should have a map here, is that the last ice age went down to the Delaware Water Gap and killed everything north of the Delaware Water Gap. But everything south survived, but they probably used to be up here, and they just haven't marched back up for the last 15,000 years. So we call that the Appalachian Woodlander series. So that's more regionally native. And then we have national natives. So we grow Dharma or Pulcana, a phenomenal plant. It grows great, native to the Northwest. Is it native? I don't know. You guys have to find that yourself. That's why you always use a modifier to it. Okay? And that's what's almost interesting about the native R versus the native debate. What if the plant grows 3,000 miles away from here? Does it matter in that case? I don't know, because there's certainly no pollinators that are used to pollinating Dharma, because they're all in the Pacific Northwest. So, you know, I consider them native in a way, but this is the debate that this organization is going to have to get to the bottom of more than us. And also, if you look at the list, the vast majority of the plants that are bred for are sun plants. They've got bigger flowers, right? You can sell things with bigger flowers better than you can sell things. Foliage plants is more already. It's more of a specialty niche, okay? It's something you can improve on. Shorter makes a big difference. People are breeding for shorter plants. Longer bloom time. So I was at Tower Hill Botanic Garden a couple weeks ago, and there's this one beautiful garden, and it's surrounded by these big cranes. And then there was a silphium this high, and then there was a Senna hippocarpa over here, huge, and a Verderana castrum here, and a Vernonia, no more. So these big ironweeds and all this stuff. And it was really cool, but it was a big garden. So then I'm putting the mind of the horticulturist into here. I said, that's great for a big garden, but what if you don't have a big garden? Okay. So that's why people start selecting this shorter one. Now I'm going to ask this annual address is, what if it's got the same flower, but every time it grows shorter? Does that affect the selection of a pollinator? And I'm going to guess no, but I don't know. It's an interesting question. So this is what we do as a horticulturist. The word that you constantly read when you are looking in catalogs or in descriptions of new plants is chance seedling. So there are two ways that a new plant is made. One is by all this inbreeding and crossing pollen and interspecific hybrids. The other is walking out in the garden or the nursery and seeing 1,000 white plants and then seeing one pink one. That's a chance seedling. You take that, and then, like Mark was saying, with the blue phlox, the varicata, then you take it for cuttings from then on, and you maintain the genetics clonally. And it still has that whole genetic package in there for when it drops seeds, but you then maintain that specific quality, characteristic that will attract you to it. So that's the chance seedling, Phlox David, which is very popular on the market. Was a chance seedling that was found in Pennsylvania in the garden, and it's been a great plant. Take Joe Pye weed. We still call it Eupatorium here. Little Joe was a chance seedling of Eupatorium dubia. It's shorter. It behaves in most gardens better unless you have a great big garden. There's a new one now out. Retibida columnifera, which is a really neat kind of cone flower from the prairies, and it's either reddish or yellowish, and this is the reddish one, and it's shorter, it doesn't fall over as much. This is an advantage to garden. So this is why they sell. This is why I have to pay attention to this, because it works in small gardens. Now, there's another side to this, and that's these breeders. We also read about these breeders who are producing these plants, and as soon as they start saying, it looks great in a 3-inch pot, looks great in an 8-inch pot, it means they bred it this big, and it's never going to get any bigger than that, and you're going to get the most ugly garden in the world, because it's going to be all these little mountains. So that's the other extreme, and that stuff's all patented 6 ways of Sunday, and I don't think it's doing any favors to the horticulture industry either to produce things that look good in 3-inch pots. So there's a lot of different angles to take on this. So, Michael mentioned a lot of mitigation problems. I think it's important to point out from a horticulturist, from a nursing point of view, that there's two reasons that plants are grown, native plants are grown. One is for the ornamental market, one's for the mitigation market, and they're totally different. And one of the big reasons they're totally different is if I grow something, we grow almost solely for the ornamental market, so it has to look good. So that means we have to can't just be a stalk with a flower on it. It has to have good shape. The bottom leaves have to still be good. It has to present well in the garden. For the mitigation market, you should see what they got away with. And they got these trays of stuff that's all you can cut back and extend them as long as it lives. Am I right? Or is that changing? It's really neat. So it would be a lot easier to grow. And I have a feeling, volume-wise, that the mitigation market, although we as gardeners don't hear it as much, is really a larger share of the market for native plants. Now, working with large, with landscapers, we see a lot of plant lists coming through. And what's kind of neat is we're starting to see now, so we see these lists, and they're looking for, these are big estates, tons of plants. And there's all the ornamental stuff, you know, that's going to go around the house. But at the end, you see a list of ornamental plants, open species plants. So what they're starting to do is they're starting to plant around the house and around the pool with nativars, and then a meadow out here that is going to actually just be a wild meadow. And I think that's a neat step. So it's starting to come about, this change. So that was kind of me dealing with the first question. And the second question is, what is the challenge of growing landscape plants from diverse sources? And I'm going to kind of tweak that a little bit, just to grow in landscape plants in general and deal with the sources a little bit as well. But, the biggest challenge is genetic diversity. And the interesting thing is, because that's the crux of what this whole nativar thing is, right? That before the pollinator issue, and it's interesting that Mark brought it up, because I hadn't heard it brought out that way, that one of the problems with the nativars is you lose genetic variability. But that used to be the big key talking point, but now it's mostly, since the research about pollinators come out, it's more talking about the pollinators. So the fact that there's variability makes it harder on us as nurserymen to grow. It was also interesting when Michael was describing how they collect seeds, so they're going to get a very diverse population from the S1 area or whatever, and then the S2, they're going to have some from the median and from the outliers, I think they have it right. When we go out to collect seeds, we don't do that. We go out and say, which ones are the good looking ones? Which are the strong ones? Because our gardeners want strong plants. So we go collect seeds from the strong looking plants. Okay? And then we'll sow them. And the next year we'll go back to the same population, a different population, and we look for more of the big strong plants, but maybe not the two tall ones. We get plants with characteristics that we as gardeners want. So even though we're collecting wild seeds, we're already being selective, okay? And then we put them in a seed tray and we let them germinate. And depending on what it is, either 90% or 100% or 50% or 10% germinate. And those are the plants we then collect seeds off of again. So now we've already eliminated some of the poor germinators, right? And then we go through this process for a while. And until we develop, and we develop a strain. So even though we're really working with an open pollinated seed, we are selecting for the survivors. Because as gardeners, we want survivors. No plant's going to live in the garden. So we're already doing a fair amount of selecting. We're hoping to improve the germination, and B, we're hoping to get a good characteristic. So then, in the middle of all this, a number of years ago, I was talking to Bill Brombeck, conservation specialist here, he's a great guy, and he said to me, and it blew me away, he said, all right, if you collect seeds from the wild, and then you put them in a display garden, you can only count the wild collected off of that seed bed for 3 years, because you're now eliminating the interaction with the wild population. I'm going, oh no, this just got a lot harder. Go back and get more. And go, every 3 years, go back and get more, and I assume that's still the rule. So we didn't know that. So that's why we need to depend on people like you guys to get the seeds going, because that's going to derail the train if we have to, every year, 3 years, go back and find some more plants. So It's very interesting to see how this works. And frankly, when we sell plants, we don't sell them as local provenance. We sell them as just a species, distant species. And we've discussed with the Wildflower Society, it would be cool if we could grow these seeds and say, at least they have a New England provenance. Okay. But we're not there yet. And so other species issues, and I'm sticking with a bit about gardens. Garden plants have to do well in gardens. And one of the reasons they become good garden plants is that they do well in gardens. But there's a fair amount of outliers because everyone, you know, it's not uncommon to have a sandy garden or a swampy garden or something like that. So as nursery people, when we get Asclepias tuberosa, which is very popular now, that's hard to grow in a pot. It has a taproot that doesn't like a pot. It likes very well-drained soils. That's a challenge. Then the same thing with some of the swampy stuff, some of the really wet plants. It's hard to grow those things in containers unless you're a small grower and they can really babysit the different conditions. Okay. So a lot of these things are good for especially nurseries, but when you get larger, it gets to be really a challenge to grow them. I already said that the variability in the seed collected stuff, you know, some germinates in 1 year, some germinates in 2 years, some gets to be tall, some gets to be short, some has good basal breaking, some doesn't. So a lot of variability, and that's a huge challenge for us. And also along with this is variability overwintering. Perennial plants have to overwinter, or they aren't worth anything to us. So we grow a lot, 90% of our plants we grow and we let them sit over the winter, and if they die in the winter, that's not a good thing. But this is part of the variability. Some overwinter better than the others. And we've gotten some seed stocks that do all these things very well, and some seed stocks that don't do it very well, and we do the exact same thing to them as far as we can see. So there are challenges, and we don't get this as much when we're buying the horticultural seed that's been bred in Kew for 100 years, and they select. Even if it's still a species plant, it's a whole different animal. So that's a challenge to us, too. Other big challenges of growing native seeds is getting them to germinate, and this is any kind of seeds, really, the different dormancy challenges, double dormancy, so it has to have a couple cold periods. Seeds that drop in the ground in August and September, they don't want to germinate that year. They want to have at least one winter, because if they germinate in September, there's not enough plant to survive the winter, so you need to get them cold for one winter, so it knows it gets in the spring. And some plants, for some reason, Mother Nature decided to make it so they have to sit for two winters. I don't know why. So the double doors have to look at two winters. That becomes a challenge. Or scarification, aphesia seeds, seeds like that, they grow in dry areas. They want you to, they're not going to germinate until there's a good rainfall, so then when a stream comes through and the sand does this with them, it breaks down the hard seed coat and helps the germinate. So we have to deal with all that stuff. Perry over there is our propagator in fact. He does that all for us with that growth. Does a great job. So there's subtle knacks to all of these plants. And that's part of the challenge. And when you add these species plants, it gets a little more challenging. But a lot more fun too. And then the actual question was with growing landscape plants from many sources, which is interesting because we work with Kate with a lot of plants in that. So here's the issue. If we're growing I'm mentioning Asclepias tuberosa, so let's stick with that. And we're growing 1,000 of them, and then Kate sends us 100 that she's germinated up in Nasami. There's going to be some genetic difference. The soil that she has the liner in might be different than the soil we have our liner in. The timing, they might dump 3 weeks later. And we've worked real hard, but that's one of the challenges we have with all the specialty stuff is if we can't flow it into the main core of our growing, it just becomes that much more of a challenge for us. Especially soils, I've briefly talked about that. This year, for the first time, we've added mycorrhizal fungi to all of our soils, hoping to you know, and then you do more reading about it, and you realize that each plant has their own symbiotic relationship. And you're hoping that what you're getting has got a good shotgun effect, but you never know. So we're trying that. I don't know if I'm seeing a huge difference yet, but I haven't given up by any means. I'm going to be working with this for a number of years. And then one of the biggest challenges for us, and this might sound stupid, but there's certain plants that come up late. And these are pain. Because, I mean, I think of hibiscus, ruellia, spagellia, rexias, gutellarias. These things come up really, really late. So now it's June 15th and people are saying, do you still have the other plant yet? I say, yeah, I do. I don't know if it's alive yet. But we have it. They say, well, will you send it anyhow? We say, well, we will, but it might not come up. And they say, that's fine. And then 2 weeks later, the plant didn't come up. What's wrong? I said, I told you. It's the challenge that we go. And then we learned another great lesson. We said, all right, well, that's great. We're going to put them in a greenhouse. We're going to force them on. So they put them in a greenhouse and force them on. And we got them going a month in advance, a month ahead of schedule. And we said, all right, but now we want to harden off, so we take the cover off the greenhouse. And one thing you don't realize is if a plant spends all of May underground, it hasn't developed any frost tolerance. The first frost comes and kills them dead as a doornail. You know, you don't think about it. These are perfectly hardy plants, but they're not. They haven't developed frost tolerance because they don't get exposed to frost. So, more challenges. So, in closing, the species plants is a niche market. I think there's a lot of growth in it, and I think this is the group, or representative of the group that's going to make that happen. So, I think that's cool to be part of it. There will continue to be new cultivars developed, because there's a lot of people out there figuring out they can make a living out of this. It just takes one person taking one species that has been played with, say a sylphium, and saying, this one's shorter, or oh, this one's orange and not yellow, or this one's red, and the race has begun, because now all these different companies, they start trying to breed their own to get in the market, because they're trying to piggyback on other people's marketing. There's tons of money goes into stuff, and then that whole species is going to change. And what they do then is the marketers start advertising this short this and this short that, and it changes the perspective of the general public, and it really has a huge effect, more than I would have guessed. So there are going to be more of these, and they're going to be altering different genera. I don't know which ones now, but it's kind of like GM was one of the new sweethearts. They're getting spread all over the place. And 5 years ago, there were like three cultivars out there. Seed availability is critical. If we can't get the seeds, we can't do it, because unless we hire our own seed collectors, but I can tell you that's a very special job, someone who really can tell the difference between these things. When they're in the stage of seed collection, it's very hard to find. And if the ornamental trade starts wanting plants from specific provenance, they're going to have to provide those seeds, because and leave time to grow them, because now, if you think about us being asked for, well, we want Lobelia cardinalis, but we want it from a Western Massachusetts provenance, we're going to, and then someone else from Maine and someone else from Connecticut, that's going to drive us crazy. So you guys are going to have to say, all right, here's the seed, and let us have it in 6 or 8 months. That at least that's how I see it happening, if that starts becoming a criterion. And lastly, I think both of these are great organizations doing good things.